Dann so eine, basically eine, also, who are we, ne? So our core competence, ne, is ne, protein engineering. We are divided, ne, in five, ne, divisions, ne? So we develop a lot of methods, ne, for protein engineering and basically want to understand on the molecular level how, for example, interactions, ne, with surfaces, ne, work. And because of these methods, we work a lot, ne, with, ne, companies together, ne? In 2014, we brought the DWI into the Leibniz Society as I can see here a picture as a Leibniz Institute for Interactive Materials. And there we basically developed an adhesion promoting platform to bind all the kind of things on surfaces. And based on that, we developed in the bioeconomy and science center degree and release technology. This will basically be the main focus of the talk today. We also established two startup companies in that area. So the first part, what I will talk about is are the two technology platforms, so the green release and V4Prots technologies, and then try to give you a flavor how the protein engineering can be used, for example, to tune selectivities, that you can bind something on a plant leaf, but not on the fruit, or to improve rain fastness, so to have something like a selective binding. So on here you see basically these two technology platforms. So B4Prot stands for B-functional proteins. They consist of a peptide that binds to the VEX layer of plant leaves. Then you have here a spacer, and you can basically genetically fuse there any kind of moiety there that, for example, could be an antimicrobial peptide. You can, instead of using an antimicrobial, antifungal peptide, decorate containers that you can also glue on the surfaces. This is a special type of containers. It's a microgel that come out of an SFB at RWTH Aachen that is now getting in the third funding phase. And you can load this container with all kinds of compounds and tune to the cross-linking density, the release kinetics over days or over weeks. So what can this adhesion promoting peptides basically do for you? Because they have a three-dimensional structure, usually in the size of, let's say, 2 to 5 nanometers, they can glue very strongly on surface, much stronger than a standard formulations, polymer formulations that you have. Since they are peptides, they are of course biodegradable, and you can, when you basically quantify them on a surface per square centimeter, you have more than a million of this adhesion promoting peptides on the surface. It's really a very dense coating. So what does this basically allow you to do? So if you have, for example, compounds that are easily washed away when it rains, you can keep them longer on the surface. Or in case of the green gels, so this with these containers, you can control release kinetics over days or weeks, and you have to do less spraying. So you reduce the number of the applications, and that's perhaps from the footprint point of view also not bad. And this is a general platform that we can have basically for this green gels, three types, and we can go from small ions to very big proteins. So we are not very broad possibilities in terms of pesticides or insecticides. When you looked, we made an interview then with farmers, and what they basically told us back is that the rain fastness and the reduction, and these are for them the main drivers or interest if they want to apply the technology. Here is an example on a sugar beet. So you see here from the pathogens, lesions. Here, this is a standard copper formulation that you put on. And this is a control with a microgel without the adhesion promoting peptide, and this is the adhesion promoting peptide with the gel. And there you basically see, even with 10 times reduced copper concentrations, that the symptoms are drastically reduced. We could reproduce that up to 40 times lower. And that is the reason for that is copper is a salt. And when it rains, when you put sodium chloride in water, it easily dissolves and gets washed off. So to the history, so the technology was developed in the Bioeconomy Science Center. It started with a seed fund project, so a small project with Professor Goldbach at that time for the release of iron, where you can see from the nutrition here that you get these green spots. Then a very nice project was a little bigger one, Boost Fund project, especially with Professor Groth, where basically his ripening delaying peptides were incorporated in the microgels, so that could then slowly release. So with this, you can basically broaden the time frame when you have to harvest crops, when you store them, that you reduce loss because they all mature at the same time. And for this we developed, for example, an adhesion promoting peptide that is switchable. So at pH 7 it nicely binds, and when you go slightly below pH 5, the histidines are protonated and completely deattaches from the surface, because nobody wants to have microgels or something like that on a fruit or vegetable surface. And then we had a very nice project together with Professor Konrad, where a B-functional peptide was made to fight soybean rust. And perhaps you can see it if your screen isn't big enough. You have to be aware that these peptides, they are not formulated. So they only bind to the wax layers of the surface of plants. And there you already see significant reductions of symptoms against soybean rust. Currently, the technology is upscaled in the Bioeconomy Science Center and the Focus Labs. So we have here as groups on the technology side, Professor Pich and us, in respect to the plant pathogen applications, is Professor Konrad and Professor Nogan, and especially Dr. Schirm, because Professor Nogan retired, who is doing the experiments. Stephanie Bröhring is looking at the economics, and Professor Knief is looking then at the biosafety, so is the microbiome on the plant leaf surface changed, or when this goes in the soil, it's degraded, so it's not much change, it's degraded. I think I don't have to say anything about Uli, for he's basically, I don't have to say much. And then, Georg is basically looking for some herbicides, and Professor Gohlke is looking at some rational understanding of the binding mechanisms. And all this focus lab is coordinated by Dr. Felix Jakob, who is in our group. Yeah, we have in the meantime an advisory board, that's nice. So what are we looking there? We are looking basically at the binding efficiency, at the release kinetics. We developed three different types of microgels that are, of course, biodegradable. We don't want to get into the discussion that we bring microplastic into the environment. And the second generation will basically be based on materials similar to the paper. And if you say, oh, you can bring, put paper into soil, nobody will argue with that. Of course, we're looking there mainly at rain fastness, plant. So we don't see, for example, any changes in the photosynthesis or in the plant growth or in the change of the microbiome. And we see a good degradation of the plant product. Plant products. So the main crops that we are looking there is apple and sugar beets, mainly copper formulations. Potato is close. We try to do as much as possible there too. And for the herbicides, it's basically to look at some weeds to kill them. And we have basically a new project that started recently based on these results for wine grapes. So we upscaled in the Leibniz Institute the production So we basically also the board reactors for that, so that we can produce the microgels, decorated really in kilogram scales for field trials. And one field trial is basically then also for this, we made 120 liters of the green release formulation with copper, is currently going on at the Landwirtschaftskammer Nordrhein-Westfalen as an independent evaluator with a reduced fungicide concentration. So we're eagerly awaiting the results. So the first results that we are getting, when you look here, are quite promising, but we wait and basically for the report. And you see here Dr. Schirm, who is basically taking care of the experiments. So what were the main achievements from the green release and bee food plots technology? Basic patent was filed. In the meantime, we have a bee here, so it's also granted with the highest claims in the European Union. An innovation award from the bioregions in Germany was won recently last year in a business competition. And in case of the bee food plots, we see really significant reductions also of symptoms, and we're then quite surprised and happy that there was a science news article about this publication where it basically claimed that this bee food plots, that they open up a treasure box of opportunities for plant health. Since I'm not a plant health expert, of course, we were then very happy about that. And here you can basically, I cannot switch it on. So let me see whether I can go out to give you an impression. No, I cannot go. So I go back to the cursor, if possible. I'm not managing to. It's basically an animation where you can see the microgel. That is a really fluffy particle. In the second generation, it will basically swell when there is no water around, so that you have release. When it's warm, the polymer chains get in motion and then collapse, so that you basically release fungicide, pesticide, only when there's a real demand, basically when it's humid, not when it's only hot and dry. So this was basically the first part, introducing the technology platforms. And now I would like to give you a little bit of a glimpse of what you can do with protein engineering to tune the binding strength. So what you see here is one of the most successful folds for adhesion promoting on surfaces. So it basically looks like a flat hand. And the cool thing about this peptide is you see here all the side chains going down. So you have side chains going down, side chains going up. And you can basically tune the lower part, for example, that it binds selectively to the plant leaves or to wax layers, and here, which is more hydrophobic. And here you have more hydrophilic parts to keep it in solution. So in principle, you can basically engineer peptides that when you have leaves and fruits or vegetables, when you spray it on, that they only like to bind either on the leaf or on the fruit. Because the surfaces of fruits are usually more hydrophilic compared to the wax layers of plant leaves. So in order to address this surface binding, we have over the years found out which structures are proteolytically stable, which one we can well engineer and construct it. In the meantime, more of 100 constructs of these adhesion-promoting peptides. This is this part that binds on the surface. Then you can cleave this off if you don't want it. Here you have a spacer that you don't have any intramolecular interaction, because if you have an intramolecular interaction, then the peptide would not bind to the surface anymore. And these constructs are usually made with EGFP, because as you can see here on a plant leaf, the wax layers where it's green fluorescenting, you have wax layers because you can then by microscopy easily see on surfaces where they are. here you see the fermenters that we have in the Leibniz Institute, so we can really produce them in gram scale without further optimizations. These adhesion-promoting peptides can bind to all kinds of surfaces, polypropylene foams, metals, alloys, titanium implants, conducting polymers, ceramics, or natural surfaces like plant leaves, or hair, or teeth. This is not really a challenge anymore. So if you see from application points of view benefits for some specific binding or binding on surfaces, this is something where we have a platform there to do, and we are always happy to get inquiries whether we have a peptide that binds to a certain surface. And since we have them on the shelf, depending on which technician is available, we can basically usually provide you within 2 or 3 weeks back a peptide that binds. So for the methodologies of this protein engineering by directed evolution in 2018, a Nobel Prize in chemistry was given, because when you look, for example, at bioethanol production, so the enzymes that are used in there to degrade the polymers, the biomass, they are all engineered by directed evolution. When you do your laundry, when you bake your bread, everywhere you find basically the enzymes that are engineered to match application conditions, because the enzymes that are usually found in nature are not designed to produce grams amounts or molar concentrations of products. So Francis got this Nobel Prize for the evolution of enzymes related to energy, so bioethanol, and you can use the same methods to basically make antibodies. And in principle, you can make with directed evolution and this process peptides selective like antibodies for certain surfaces. How does a directed evolution work? So you start with one gene that encodes the protein that you want to improve. You, on the gene level, you randomly introduce mutations. In 2/3 of the cases, when you then do the screening, you get changes on the amino acid level. So every selection pressure that you can apply, be it improved temperature, improved activity, selectivity, you can then select those variants that are improved in that property, and you start this process again. The methods for this random mutagenesis were, for example, developed in the late 80s, and you can generate 10 to the power of 6 to 10 to the power of 8 different mutants in 2 to 3 hours by error-prone PCR. And today there are also screening methods available, and some of them we have developed, where you can really screen these millions of variants in 1 hour. So you can basically accelerate natural evolution millionfold by selecting the peptides to do what you're interested in. So the key technologies are the diversity generation and the high throughput screening. And surprisingly, when you screen only a few thousand variants, you usually find improved variants. So what did we do as a first step? We basically developed a method that we can evolve these small peptides that are doing the adhesion promoting. They are too big to be made chemically, but very small in terms of a protein with 30 to 60 amino acids. Usually you make 3 to 5 mutations per 1,000 base pairs. So we had to generate a polymerase that makes many more mutations, so that we can basically efficiently use this directed evolution methodologies to make better binding peptides. And here is, for example, a simple screening to improve the binding on a hydrophobic polymer surface in the presence of a detergent. So if you have a detergent in a formulation and you still want the peptide to spread it and to have a strong binding on the surface, this can easily be done. We further developed a method where we can display these millions of variants on the surface of the cells, and then by a very simple procedure, select then better binders or selective binders. If you have questions to that, we can gladly go into the details of the methods. So now, how does such a result look like in the process, in a sense that we basically developed and published 7 years ago, that we termed Novolution? We usually evolve the peptides. Novolutions has the goal to minimize the experimental efforts that you have to put in and maximize the benefit that you get by combining experimental and computational methods. So in the first phase, you do, as I have shown before, a standard directed evolution experiment where you find positions that are improved. Then you explore all the natural diversity. You look in the structure where they are. They usually cluster in 2 to 3 areas. And then by computational methods, you can easily identify more positions in close proximity that have similar effects. And then you need a good strategy to recombine them to get a strong binding. And here's basically how such a matrix looks like that you get best. So you find the positions that are then important for the binding. You know on the molecular level which building blocks of nature, which amino acid are exchanged. And by the analysis of this that are better binding, stronger binding, you can on the molecular level understand the binding mechanism. And by this then also further improve the binding or make it more selective. And this is basically our core competence to understand those interactions on the molecular level. So this is then, for example, more than 5-fold stronger binding on polypropylene, which textile people have a lot of problems in dyeing because it's so hydrophobic and there are barely any interactions. To give you a little bit, in the concluding part, a glimpse on how do these adhesion-promoting peptides look like. So if you take here a silicon wafer, you can basically coat a silicon wafer with something that is hydrophilic, hydrophobic, or hydrophilic again, and then you put a water droplet and on, then you can by simple contact angle measurements of this water droplet get an idea about the chemical properties of the surface. And there are peptides that bind selectively on surface. And for example, you can imagine if you remember the peptide with the hand, you can, for example, put in 2 strands that bind on polypropylene, 2 that bind on something hydrophilic, and you can make general binders. And you see this is a general binding peptide that the contact angle is around 72 degrees after the coating. You can then literally take the silicon wafer, scratch the surface, and this is shown on the right side. Here is the scratch surface, and you can with an AFM tip go over the surface, and then you see a height difference of 4 nanometers. And this height difference of 4 nanometers corresponds very well to a monolayer often such a protein. And very often the textile people in the Leibniz Institute always told us, oh, the peptides are expensive and a lot of things why peptides are so bad. But you can produce any specialty protein like such a peptide for around 1,000 euro per kilo. And the enzymes that you have in your laundry formulations are much cheaper. And that's 1 euro per gram. And with 1 gram, we promised the collaborators that you can coat a surface of 250 square meters. So then even for textile and carpet producers, this got interesting. And when you look in the publications, calculated something like 600 something square meters. So there's a little bit of safety margin in there. So the proteins are at the end not really in a cost factor. Going one back. When you look at the surface density, you can usually achieve a surface coverage of more than 19%. So this you can quantify with exometry and other measurements within the fastest ones were 30 seconds. And some took up to an hour to reach this level. And if you go now back to basically a microgel, You don't need a full coverage of the surface. You even need much less peptide to do the binding. So basically, I hope that with this I could basically show you that BFU ports and green release are two attractive technologies to reduce the amount of pesticides, fungicides that you can use. They are biodegradable. They can be produced in sufficient amount to be used in field trials. And of course, we are very much interested in problems that are there that we could basically solve with the technology. And I also basically hoped that on the second part that I could convince you that this protein engineering methods and especially directed evolution is a quite powerful method to tune peptides and proteins to application conditions. You can make them selective for surfaces like antibodies. You can improve rain fastness, and you can also make them triggerable. What we have is a pH trigger currently. There are also light triggers or other triggers in terms of salt in development. So and with this, I would like to conclude the presentation. Thank you for the attention and looking forward to your questions.